Welcome back to CBS This Morning and our special hour, Coronavirus, a Race to Respond. So our goal this morning is this, to inform you about what we know, where we're headed, and how to protect yourself and your family. As the virus spreads, we are starting to hear firsthand accounts of people directly affected, including passengers who were quarantined on the Diamond Princess cruise ship.
For me, the virus felt like a common cold. My wife and I did Valentine's Day quarantined on the Diamond Princess together. I'm feeling fine. I had a high fever of 103 plus. I've had a dry cough. If I wasn't contagious, I would have been back at work the next day.
The coronavirus swept through the ship. I ended up testing positive relatively early on in the quarantines, and I was removed from the ship and placed in a hospital in downtown Tokyo, where I spent exactly 3 weeks.
My experience was thankfully very mild. There's no reason to panic. It's just a sickness, and it will run its course.
As the virus spreads here in the U.S., we brought together a panel of health experts to answer your questions. CBS News medical contributor, you know her well, Dr. Tara Narula, is back with us. We're also joined by Michael Osterholm, director of the Center for Infectious Disease Research and Policy at the University of Minnesota. He knows a lot. And Dr. Vin Gupta, he's a respiratory specialist and global health policy expert. Welcome, doctors. I want to start with you, Michael. Can we just talk about the ship for a second? What do you think when you see that?
It is a cruel human experiment.
Why?
We know that cruise ships facilitate transmission just by the air circulation in the inner cabins, and the Diamond Princess was proof in pudding of that. And every cruise ship where we have this, where you keep people out to sea, it's just a matter of time before many of them get ill. We've got to get them off the ship, get them on land. You can quarantine them there if you want to do that, but get them off the ship.
Let's talk about the rest of us who aren't on ships, because I'm wondering how scared you should be. I had always thought, many people think, if you haven't been to Italy, China, South Korea, Italy, or any of the affected countries, and you haven't come in contact with any of those people, that you're pretty okay.
You know, right now, we have pretty much a homogeneous viral reactor around the world.
Meaning so you're not
basically
okay.
It's not. It's what we knew would happen. We predicted a month ago that we would suddenly see activity pick up in the United States. Today, Seattle has as many cases as many other of the countries that we've mentioned that are having a problem. And we're going to have more Seattles around the country in just the next few days to weeks. So it's you have to now, just like seasonal influenza, you have to assume that this is everywhere right now, and anyone could potentially be infected that way.
So, Tara, in terms of testing, should you only get tested if you have symptoms? Should everybody be tested? What are the parameters here?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting question. And certainly there was a change this past week. And so basically that change said that anyone can get tested with the permission of their doctor. But what we're looking at are people who have the symptoms we know are associated with COVID-19, which is fever, shortness of breath, cough. In that, if you have those symptoms, you should speak to your doctor and let the doctor really get an assessment of your clinical picture, what your travel history or exposure history might be, and then make a decision as to whether you should be tested. And at that point, you know, you will be either sent to a hospital or, you know, at some point have it done in the clinic when those lab tests become available.
Dr. Gupta, what does the coronavirus actually do to your body?
Basically, at any point of entry to the body, the sinuses, the oral pharynx, your gastrointestinal tract, what it does is it invades the lining of those cavities, mm-hmm. causes local inflammation, and that's when you have symptoms. That's when you have shortness of breath. That's when you have cough. You have a runny nose. And we're also seeing you sometimes have GI symptoms as well. And so that is what's happening at the cellular level.
Do you always have symptoms?
So one of the interesting dynamics here is that we're seeing potentially asymptomatic transmission here, where people are not actually demonstrating classic symptoms of cough, shortness of breath, fever, but they're able to transmit the disease. I will say one thing on testing. One of the struggles we have, and everything Tara said is absolutely correct, is we don't know these emergency tests that are coming that are just cleared by the FDA. Who knows how they function in the field? We have no idea.
We don't know if they're going to work, you're saying?
Well, we hope they do, and I hope they're better than what was initially deployed 4 weeks ago to the States. But who's to say how they're going to actually function in the field? Are they going to be highly sensitive enough? We hope. That's the key piece, and that's the unknown.
Michael, are we prepared for this to spread across the country?
Well, we're prepared in the sense that we know it's coming, and we know that our healthcare facilities are going to have a major increase in load. That's not an issue of debate. What is a concern is how prepared are we at the healthcare level in particular?
Are we prepared?
And we're not. We have 45,000 beds in this country for intensive care medicine, and any one given day they're filled.
Can you get this, not know you have it, and recover without being treated?
Yes. In fact, the vast majority, what we now know is that in the first day of your infection, where you're actually putting virus out, you may not even have symptoms, as we just heard from Dr. Gupta. But then we know that over the next 3 to 5 days, you have this upper respiratory infection, that, just like the flu type of picture. Mm-hmm. For some reason, a large risk is there for people who are over age 55, 60, who have underlying health problems, for the virus then getting into the lungs and then causing the additional problem. The vast majority of people will never experience that. They're just going to have those first couple of days of respiratory symptoms.
And they can get through it.
And they won't even be treated, and they'll be fine.
But they might infect others. Dr. Gupta, we have a question from a viewer in Minnesota, Lori. Let's listen to that.
I would like to know how long the virus lives on the various surfaces.
That's a good question.
It's such a good question. Yeah. And I think what we know now, we have studies that show it depends on ambient temperature, number one, and then on the surface. And so depending on the temperature, if it's, say, 70 degrees, you can see fomites, basically the virus particles, live on surfaces like paper or steel up to anywhere from 2 hours to 9 days. But if it's ambient, if it's, say, 60 to 70 degrees, longer lifespan. If it's hotter or colder, shorter lifespan.
Michael, another viewer asked a question. Should we be limiting our air travel and gatherings of large numbers of people? South by Southwest is scheduled for next week. Right now, it's still on, those kind of gatherings.
You know, today, if you're someone who is over age 55, you're someone who has underlying health problems, I would say don't put yourself at risk in being in those large gatherings. Younger age populations have seen very little serious illness. In fact, no one in Korea under age 30 has died. In China, only 2.1% of the cases were in people 19 years of age or younger. So again, I think we have to start looking carefully. One of the areas that we're very concerned about is school closings. Mostly today, the illness is going to be in adults, and if it's not in kids, should we be closing schools? Well, maybe yes, if they're shedding the virus. If they're getting infected, not sick, and shedding the virus, then we should. So, yeah, at this point, distancing for people with underlying health problems, though, is a real, I think, important issue.
Tara, we want to do a quick reality check on some of the things that we've been hearing about. The first, a face mask, which is getting a lot of attention. Do face masks actually protect you from the virus?
No, right? And we've been trying to make this point loud and clear. The Surgeon General tried to make this point. Stop buying face masks. So the surgical masks that you see everybody walking around with are not able to prevent those viral particles from getting to you. They can go around. They're not, you know, fitted to your face appropriately. The N95 respirator masks that the healthcare professionals use are meant to keep out 95% of very small particles.
We should save them for the healthcare workers.
We should, yes.
Michael, is this more or less contagious than the traditional flu?
You know, this is just like influenza in every way possible. And the way I describe it, it's like trying to control the wind. You know, and anyone that would suggest trying to stop a seasonal flu year by trying to control it somehow, it would be laughed out of the room. It's really about either vaccine for flu. This one, we don't have a vaccine, so we're pretty much at the whims of this kind of respiratory transmission.
Dr. Gupta, we've been talking about people, but what about pets? I mean, this came from an animal. Can it go back to an animal?
A lot of people asking about pets.
Yeah.
There's a case of the dog in Hong Kong, I believe, that tested weakly positive for the virus. What I can say, the evidence that exists today suggests no. You cannot actually acquire coronavirus from a pet. I think we'll wait. It's a wait-and-see approach, though, because we just don't know enough information. But right now, the evidence suggests no.
A lot of hand sanitizer being sold
everywhere. Yeah.
What products should we be using, if any?
Any alcohol-based hand rub, which, you know, the one that we all talk about is Perel, but there are a number of them on the market, and they do help. Yeah. And they not only help with this, but we have a lot of other infectious diseases the three of us are worried about besides influenza, and that helps a lot with those, too.
Yeah. What about the liquor cabinet at home? It is a Friday. Will that wash anything away?
Get the great public health message on alcohol. That way is lots of alcohol in moderation.
Somebody said Lysol, too, Tara.
Right. So the EPA just released a 5-page letter that lists all the potential products that can be used against COVID-19, and they've been shown to be effective against viruses that are even harder to kill than COVID-19. Lysol is one of those products listed.
Also
Clorox, exactly. We know that the COVID-19 virus is surrounded, it's an enveloped virus, by a fatty layer that can be broken down easily by these disinfectants.
All right. Tara, Vin, and Michael, thank you all very much. Very helpful.